Leia here from leiaforsci.com/MCAT, and in this series, I'm going to take you through the electronic and molecular geometries when molecules have sp, sp2, sp3, and even sp3d and sp3d2 hybridization. If you're not comfortable with hybridization, go back to my videos where I show you what a hybrid is and how you get it, and you can find this on my website at leiaforsci.com/MCATgeometry. For this demonstration, I'll be using a molecular visions model kit, and you can pick up your own on Amazon by using the link below or visiting leiaforsci.com/kit. If you purchase through my link, I do get a small commission at no extra cost to you. We'll start our discussion with sp hybridization. Notice that when you have s and p, we have two groups, and that means the atom is going to have two sigma bonds and two pi. When we look at the sp hybridized atom, the sp hybridized atom has two degenerate orbitals made from s and p. And since s and p is two fused orbitals, we have a total of two groups equidistant from each other. Since s and p forms two degenerate orbitals, according to the Vesper theory, the farthest apart that they can be from each other is 180 degrees. Say we have an sp hybridized atom, and one of its orbitals is to the right, the farthest that we can place that second orbital is going to be to the left. If this is an atom that only has two bonds, for example BeCl2, we'll have the beryllium in the center, and on either side we'll have a chlorine atom, so that we get a linear molecule with a 180 degree bond angle. But if you have an atom that is sp hybridized with additional empty orbitals on this molecule, this is where you start to see your double and your triple bonds. For example, the molecule ethine or acetylene is HC triple bound CH. Both carbon atoms are the same, so let's take a look at just one of these carbon atoms which we're showing in red. The carbon atom has two degenerate hybrid orbitals, one forming a sigma bond to hydrogen on the left, and the other forming a sigma bond to the carbon on the right. But in addition to the sp hybridization, this carbon atom also has two p orbitals. We have one p orbital sitting in the y plane, which is up and down, and that's going to form a bond with the carbon on the right that also has the p orbital in the y plane. The second p orbital is sitting in the z plane. So to show the z plane, we'll have the dark part of the orbital to show that it's coming forward, it's bold, it's coming right out of the page at you, and then we'll show the light one going into the page, it's fading away, it's harder to see. And again, these electrons will overlap, forming that second pi bond. Now let's see it on the model kit. Notice we have two carbon atoms bound to each other with two hydrogens on the end. The carbons have a sigma bond in the middle that's hard to see, we have a pi bond in the y plane, and another one in the z plane. That makes this molecule 180 degrees, which is linear in both its electronic and molecular geometry. When you think of sp hybridization, it doesn't just have to be a molecule that has a triple bond. For example, here we have carbon dioxide with a carbon in the center and two oxygen atoms. Notice that the oxygens each have three groups, and that makes them sp2 hybridized, but the central carbon is sp with one double bond to the oxygen on one side and the other double bond on the other side. So while the oxygen atoms are sp2, the central carbon is sp with a pi bond in the z plane and another one in the y plane. Just like ethine, the carbon is sp, which means it's linear and 180 degrees. Now let's see what it looks like on paper. If we have the molecule CO2 and we draw it out, we have a central carbon atom double bound to two oxygen atoms as far away from each other, so once again we have that linear geometry and 180 degree bond angle. You can recognize that the carbon atom is sp hybridized because it only has two groups attached to it, but the oxygen atoms are each sp2 hybridized because in addition to the molecule attached, we also have the two lone electron pairs which still take up space, which still influence the other electrons around the molecule and still push those away according to the Vesper theory. But we're focusing on sp for now, so let's take a look at the hybridized carbon and we'll draw the two oxygen atoms on either side. The carbon is going to have a sigma bond to each of the oxygen atoms, but the carbon also has two p orbitals. We'll show the first one in the y-plane, and one of the oxygen atoms will be oriented so that its p orbital is also in the y-plane. These electrons can overlap, forming a pi bond in the y-plane. The carbon atom has that second p orbital in the z-plane, so we show half of the p orbital coming forward and the other half going back. The oxygen atom on the left is going to orient its p orbital in the same direction, so that once again we can have a pi bond, but this time it's in the z-plane. The oxygen to the right is going to have two electron pairs, one forward and back. The oxygen on the left has them up and down. But when you're looking at the molecular geometry, we only look at what we actually see in terms of the atoms. And because the oxygen atoms are as far away from carbon as possible, once again we have that linear geometry and 180-degree bond angle. Now let's take a look at the sp2 hybridization, recognizing that sp2 is made by combining s plus p, sp squared or sp2, giving me three degenerate orbitals, which can be occupied as a bond to another atom or as a lone pair of electrons, which you can almost imagine as a bond to itself. This will help you see that it takes up space, but at the same time, there isn't actually an atom attached over there. If we want to see the electronic geometry for something sp2, just think about that central carbon atom and three groups around it. According to the Vesper theory, the farthest that these three can go is potentially one straight up, one down to the left, one down to the right, or any version of this form. Let's take a look at the tertbutyl carbocation as our example. Tertbutyl, or tertiary butyl, is an isomer of butane where carbon has three methyl groups bound to it. The tertbutyl carbocation gives you a central carbon atom with only three bonds and an empty p orbital. This is how you get that formal charge of plus one. But when you look at the actual molecule, we just see the carbon and the three groups bound to it. That empty p orbital doesn't actually take up space, and so we don't account for it in the structure. So here we have the tertbutyl cation. Notice that we have a carbon in the center with three methyl groups. Each center is a carbon, and these represent my hydrogen atoms. Notice that the carbon has only three bonds coming out of it, with an empty p orbital sitting here, but we don't see it because that's the nature of the carbocation, the fact that it's empty. Notice that the central carbon, the blue carbon, is triangular in shape and flat, and that's why we have a trigonal planar geometry. If you imagine this is a circle and cut the circle in three, we get a 120-degree bond angle. Typically, when you think of sp2 hybridization, you're thinking of a pi bond. So here we have acetone, or simply propanone. Here we have the oxygen atom, where the two red groups are simply the lone pairs of electrons, and here we have our two carbon atoms. Notice that the central carbon atom has three groups coming out of it. Here we have a sigma and pi bond, and here we have two sigma bonds. Once again, this molecule is relatively flat. We still have that triangle shape, and that gives us a trigonal planar geometry at 120 degrees. Now let's take a sideways view of this molecule so you can actually see that pi bond. We'll make that central carbon atom purple, and we'll bind it to a purple oxygen atom. They are bound first with a sigma bond, and the carbon is also bound to a methyl group coming forward, so that's a CH3 in bold. And then another methyl group going back, so that's a CH3 on a dotted orbital. These are all your sp2 hybrid single bonds. With oxygen, we have the same idea, but oxygen is only bound to carbon. So the other electron pairs, you need to imagine as if the oxygen has an electron bound to itself. We have that same orbital coming forward, that same orbital going back, but just imagine that it's an electron bound to an electron, and that is how you can envision your lone pair as taking up space and participating in the Vesper theory, pushing the other groups aside. What we still have is that p orbital on carbon and on oxygen. So from a side view, we have that flat molecule, and then the pi bond sits very high and very low next to the carbon and oxygen atoms. The electronic geometry is looking at the electrons and at the atoms. So both carbon and oxygen would be considered trigonal planar, but the molecular geometry only looks at the atoms, and for carbon we see something trigonal planar, for oxygen all we see is the oxygen atom. Be sure to join me in the next video where we go through the sp3 hybridization. Are you stuck on a specific MCAT topic?
I offer private online tutoring where I focus on your needs to strengthen your individual weaknesses. Tutoring details can be found using the link below or by visiting my website, layforsci.com/MCAT tutor. Are you overwhelmed by the sheer volume of information required for the MCAT? Are you worried that lack of a proper study plan and low MCAT score will prevent you from getting into medical school? My new ebook, The MCAT Exam Strategy, a 6-week guide to crushing the MCAT, will help you formulate a concrete study plan by helping you figure out where you stand now, identify your goals, and figure out what it takes to reach them. And it's yours free when you sign up for my email newsletter at MCATExamStrategy.com. By signing up for my email newsletter, you'll also be the first to know when I have new videos, MCAT study guides, cheat sheets, tips, and so much more. The link again, MCATExamStrategy.com.